As we look out upon our country, we would all agree something is wrong and it only seems to be getting worse. A new Wall Street Journal poll shows that 80% of voters believe that things are out of control in the United States. Politically and socially, we've never been more divided. Economically, we just shut down our economy and have no idea when or if we will fully recover. And over the last few weeks, we have seen anarchy on our streets. If the saying, united we stand, divided we fall, is true, we are in trouble. It seems our nation is unraveling at the seams. Now, we can place the blame on many different factors, from politicians to police to the populace. There's plenty of culpability to go around. But I believe there is something much deeper going on here. I believe we are a nation experiencing divine judgment. And to prove my point, I want to look at Romans 1:18 through 31. In this passage, we see man's rejection of God and God's response. Romans 1:18 through 19 says this, "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men, who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. For what can be known about God is plain to them, because God has shown it to them." So here is man suppressing God's revealed truth so they can live lives of unrighteousness. And notice God's response. He's not apathetic about sin in his creation. He is patient, but eventually he will respond in wrath. And notice the wrath here is not something that will happen sometime in the future on the day of judgment. The wrath is already being revealed now in the present. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness. But the way that wrath is revealed is really interesting. It's not fire bolts from the sky and the earth quaking and people fleeing and dying, what we might see in some movie about an apocalypse. This wrath is much more subtle, almost passive. This is God simply stepping back and letting people have their way. Three times in this section we are told God gave them over, or God gave them up. In other words, God begins to remove his gracious hand of restraint on a society, increasingly turning mankind over to themselves, and as he does that, man will begin to live more and more like the animals they claim to have come from. So all God has to do to judge a nation is to step back and allow people to live without him. As we see in Romans 1, they end up being the instruments of judgment themselves as they devour one another. So let's look at the downward slide of a nation or an individual into judgment in Romans 1. There are three steps, and each step down issues a warning, a divine shot across the bow, we could say, that should open our eyes to the danger we are in. And we will see the cause and effect in each step. So the first step down, the cause is this. It's in verses 18 through 20. "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. For what can be known about God is plain to them, because God has shown it to them. For his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world in the things that have been made, so they are without excuse." So God tells us he has made the truth of his existence plain to mankind through the things he has made. In other words, creation shows the clear evidence of a creator. Even the simplest cells are far too complex to have happened by random luck. So creation shouts out, this isn't an accident. There is a designer behind all we see, a creator who is wise and powerful. But rather than accept that truth, man chooses to reject God and suppress his truth. This eventually results in replacing God with idols of their own making. Romans 1:23, "And exchange the glory of the immortal God for images resembling mortal man and birds and animals and creeping things." Listen, everybody has to have a God, something they are devoted to. And if it's not the true God, they will find something else. This may be idols carved into statues. It also can be the idols of money, sex, pleasure, entertainment, drugs, drink, reputation, position, power, possession. Listen, an idol is anything that is placed above God in our affections. And so the effect is this. Here is the first clear signpost that should alert us that we are under judgment. That's Romans 1:24. Therefore, because, in other words, they have suppressed the truth God has made plain, therefore God gave them up in the lust of their hearts to impurity, to the dishonoring of their bodies among themselves. The NIV is a bit clearer. It says, therefore God gave them over in the sinful desires of their hearts to sexual impurity for the degrading of their bodies with one another. So the cause is this. Man says, I refuse to recognize you. Instead, I choose to replace you with other things. The effect, God says, fine, let me step out of the way a bit so you can taste life without me. He removes his gracious hand of restraint a bit and hands them over to themselves, and you see the evidence of that in their immorality. We could call this handing man over to themselves a judicial act of divine abandonment. But this shouldn't surprise us when it happens. It's the way it's always been. Psalm 81:11 and 12 says, but my people did not listen to my voice. Israel would not submit to me, so I gave them over to their stubborn hearts to follow their own counsels. Now, what are the evidences we are a nation under this first stage of abandonment? Well, it says, therefore God gave them over in the sinful desires of their hearts to sexual impurity for the degrading of their bodies with one another. And so the explosion of sexual impurity in the heterosexual realm was the evidence, or is the evidence. Has that happened? Well, absolutely. Well, let's be honest. There has always been lust and heterosexual sin in our society. But when it explodes onto the scene, out in the open, in an unprecedented way, that is an indicator we are in stage one of being handed over to ourselves. And we saw this begin in America in the 60s, didn't we? The era that was called the sexual revolution. Sex came out of the bedroom and out into the public. From late-night talk shows to sitcoms and prime time, sex began to dominate the airwaves. And then there was the pill. It became the symbol of the sexual revolution. Now there could be sex without consequences, so game on. That was the beginning of a moral slide that has only picked up speed. Technology has made hardcore pornography available to everybody who has a smartphone now, and Americans are taking advantage. 40 million Americans log onto a porn site every day with devastating results. It is estimated that 12 million Americans have become addicted to sex. So we definitely see the sexual explosion in the heterosexual realm in our society. The collapse of our morals should have woke us up, showing us we were in stage one of God's handing us over. But what happens if we don't repent? What happens if instead we do what verse 25 says? Now here is the cause of the next stage of judgment. Romans 1:25. Because they exchanged the truth about God for a lie and worshiped and served the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. So instead of seeing the truth and repenting, we exchange the truth about God for a lie. And notice the downward progression here. In verse 18, we are suppressing the truth. In verse 25, we get rid of the truth altogether. We simply exchange it for a lie, such as we weren't created, we evolved. Now, the result of getting rid of God's truth leads to getting rid of God. That brings us to stage two of our downward descent into judgment. God gives us over to homosexual sin. Look at verse 26 and 27. For this reason, God gave them up to dishonorable passions, for their women exchanged natural relations for those that are contrary to nature, and the men likewise gave up natural relations with women and were consumed with passion for one another, men committing shameless acts with men and receiving in themselves the due penalty for their error. So God removes his gracious hand of restraint a bit more. Now we can add to the explosion of heterosexual sin, that's the first stage, what we could call the celebration of homosexual sin, that's the second stage. And listen, this is not God causing man to sin. This is God simply removing his gracious restraints and allowing man to be who they are without him. And this forces us to rethink how we think about judgment. You know what? We say things like this. If we don't stop all this sexual immorality stuff, God is going to judge us. But if I'm reading Romans 1 right, it is saying when we see this kind of sexual immorality, both in the heterosexual and homosexual realm, that is happening because God is judging us. He's giving us over to ourselves, and immorality is the outcome. So when we see stage two, and we do, that should have caused us to say, this is getting serious. We need to repent and turn back to God. But what happens if we don't? Well, then down to stage three. Stage three of judgment. We are given over to a debased mind. That's Romans 1:28. Here's the cause. And since they did not see fit to acknowledge God, and now here's the effect. The verse continues, God gave them up to a debased mind to do what ought not to be done. Again, notice the downward progression. They suppressed the truth and told them there was a creator. Then they got rid of the truth about God, exchanging it for a lie. Now that lie has so polluted their thinking, they don't think God is worthy of taking up any of their thoughts at all. They think it's foolish to think about him at all. And that's our society today, isn't it? Bring God up in some circles amongst those who consider themselves wise, and you're looked upon as a Neanderthal, a gullible fool to be pitied. In this final judicial act of God, he turns man over to a debased mind. In other words, you insist in not wanting to think about me? I'll give you a mind that can't think about me. Welcome to having your own way. You're now on your own. Now, what is a debased mind? It is a mind so corrupt that it can no longer guide a person morally. Paul defined it as a mind that no longer stops a person from doing what is wrong. Instead, it becomes the source of wrong. Romans 1:28 again, God gave them over to a debased mind to do what ought not to be done. This is what man was like on earth before God judged it with the flood. Genesis 6:5, when the Lord saw that man's wickedness was widespread on earth and that every scheme his mind thought of was nothing but evil all the time. That is the perfect illustration of the debased mind. It doesn't restrain immorality. It continuously pumps out evil thoughts and imaginations. Now, what is the result of a society characterized by a debased mind? Well, read Romans 1:29 through 31 and see if this sounds like the headlines you read every day. See if this sounds like what you see on the news on your TV. Romans 1:29 through 31, they were filled with all manner of unrighteousness, evil, covetousness, malice. They are full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, maliciousness. They are gossips, slanderers, haters of God, insolent, haughty, boastful, inventors of evil, disobedient to parents, foolish, faithless, heartless, and ruthless. So what do we see? Do we see these three stages in our country? In the 60s, we saw an explosion of heterosexual sexual immorality, and there was no repentance. Some 40 years later, we started to see the celebration of homosexual immorality, and there was no repentance. And now the third stage, we are seeing a society characterized by a debased mind, the sins of Romans 1:29 through 31. So what do we do? Do we try to legislate this evil away, make laws tougher? Do we try to educate ourselves so we treat each other better? Do we manipulate the environment so people are more content? Well, I guess there's nothing wrong with any of that, but it is just putting a Band-Aid on a cancer that is eating us up from within. The only remedy for a nation under judgment is to cry out to God. This is the example of Israel, isn't it? They would rebel against God and experience judgment. Eventually, they would grow tired of the pain, tired of what was happening to them, and they would cry out to God and turn from their sins. Then God would deliver them and bless them again. That's exactly what we need to do. We need to cry out to God, asking Him to have mercy on us and forgive us, asking Him for the grace we need to turn from our sin and follow Him. And you know where this has to start? It has to start with us. It has to start with the church. The unbeliever's not going to call out to God. We have to. We stand in the gap. We are Christ representatives. And what did God say to Israel? Is He saying the same thing to us? He said, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and forgive their sin and will heal their land. That's 2 Chronicles 7:14. I honestly believe if the church would be what it's supposed to be, if we would quit playing with sin, if we would humble ourselves and begin to cry out to God that He will move, I believe he will bless his church, and that will overflow to our nation. The unbeliever will see Christ in us, and they will be drawn to him. God says, if you will do that, if my people will do that, I will heal their land. Now, if you want to see a man praying for his country, see what that is like, read Daniel 9. Well, this is a serious message. You know what? I'd rather teach on God's love than his wrath. But sometimes the truth must convict rather than comfort. It must trouble us rather than calm us. Well, friends, thanks for watching. Hit those buttons down below. Subscribe, like, notification, and God bless you.